site first dedicated on November 11, 1988, 20 years ago. A lot of people expended many efforts to make this site come about, including
Scripture, remind them to be loyally subject to the government and its officials, to obey laws and to be open to every good enterprise. They are to slander no one, to be peaceable, considerate, exercising all graciousness toward everyone, because it was He, our Savior, who sacrificed Himself for us, to redeem us from all unrighteousness and to claim for Himself a people of His own, eager to do what is right. Titus 3:1-7. Almighty Father, this morning on the grounds of this campus of Washburn University of Topeka, Kansas, we commemorate Veterans Day and recognize the valor of veterans living and deceased who have served our nation well. We salute them and honor their heroic sacrifices. In a special way, we remember our most current war veterans from Iraq and Afghanistan, Desert Storm and Desert Shield, and those of past wars, particularly Korea, World War II, Vietnam War, and many others, whose names will not be forgotten, neither by you, their God, nor by us, their patriots. Whether they are among the ranks of Purple Hearts and Medals of Honors, those who saw action, those whose wounds testified to their courage, all of them in one way or another have endured extreme sacrifices for freedom's ideal. We lift up to you, O Lord our God, especially all disabled veterans who have suffered greatly for their heroism and have many times been taken for granted. So too do we remember those vets still missing in action as well as those who were captured as prisoners of war. Lord our God, our hearts go to the families of our servicemen and women deployed, those who are presently carrying the torch in anticipation, awaiting their loved ones' return from the war. Please be their strength and their shield, and protect their loved ones from harm. And finally, Lord, we ask your guidance for this people of the United States of America during this time of great expectation of our upcoming presidential year. Help us to be a virtuous people, a blessed nation, a people eager to do what is right and good. And this we ask in your holy name. Amen.
Speaker this morning is Dave Booth. Dave has been a dedicated member of the Washburn University staff for over 31 years. Today, he is here speaking as a veteran. Dave served two tours of duty in Southeast Asia as a member of an elite, unclassified Special Forces squadron assigned to the United States Navy. Much of what Dave's unit did in Southeast Asia still remains classified. members of the squadron in which Dave served, only two members survived. Ironically, the other surviving member is Dave's brother, Donald. Dave's father and uncle both served in combat in World War II, and his son-in-law recently served in the Middle East. Dave has also been an active member of the Washburn University Veterans Day Committee for the past 11 years, and I can attest to the fact that he cares passionately about veterans' issues and compassionately about veterans. Please join me in welcoming Dave.
We are here today to show respect and honor all veterans. That phrase certainly holds a different meaning for each of us. Based on our experiences, and I can only share with you what it means to me. As both a veteran and a member of the Washburn University Veterans Day Committee, I am familiar with the origins of this day of remembrance. But for those of you who may be less familiar, let me give you a brief description of how we came to be here today. In 1921, an unknown World War I American soldier was buried in Arlington Cemetery, the official place of reverence for American veterans. Similar ceremonies occurred earlier in England and France, where an unknown soldier was buried in each nation's highest place of honor. This memorial gesture all took place on November 11, 1918, the 11th hour, the 11th day, the 11th month. The day became known as Armistice Day, and officially received its name in America in 1926 through a congressional resolution. It became a national holiday 12 years later by similar congressional action. After the end of World War II, Representative Edwin K. Reese of Kansas drafted a proposal to Congress to change Armistice Day to Veterans Day and make it an occasion to honor those who served America in all wars. In 1954, President Eisenhower signed a bill proclaiming November 11th as Veterans Day. Over the years, I've come to know many people who served this country. In some cases, gave the last full measure of their lives in defense of They never took part in what is termed war, or even in some cases, in what is called combat. I have also come to know many people, like myself, who under the command of one branch of the United States military or another, fought, had friends and comrades die, and killed other human beings. And some are in conflict somewhere in the world, but hesitate to be called a veteran because we weren't at war. I can't begin to tell you the number of conversations I've had with veterans, like my brother, who served his time during the Vietnam era in a remote radar station near Adak, Alaska, and how many times I've heard him say, and he's not a vet, unlike me, or my other two brothers, who saw active combat in country, but he and hundreds of others just like him endured the same hardships we did, separated from family and friends, extreme living conditions, and altered bouts of boredom and sheer terror. That soldiers, sailors, and airmen still do. And they too sometimes pay the ultimate price to protect freedoms we continue to enjoy. Or like my daughter-in-law's father, who served in the Coast Guard, but like many others, patrolled the Mekong at the same time I was there. Many people don't realize the role the Coast Guard plays both here and abroad. Iraq and Afghanistan aren't the first times that the weekend warriors, those who have typically been seen as serving 1 weekend a month and 2 weeks during the summer, have been called into combat. As my wife tells a story of her cousin, a National Guardsman in Missouri, hit dirt when he heard the whistle of a rocket shell overhead. After returning from service with an engineering company, building landing strips in Vietnam. And then there are other veterans, like my grandfather, who served World War I while running the gauntlet of German gunboat patrols, transporting supplies vital to the war effort in Europe as a merchant seaman. Along with these brave men are, of course, the service women, many of whom remain unrecognized, but who face the same trials as their male counterparts, death and injury, both physical and mental, imprisonment, heat and cold, loneliness and loss, in distant places all over the world, like Britain, Germany, Korea, Vietnam, the Gulf, Bosnia, Afghanistan, and Iraq. There's also an irony, there is also an irony about being a veteran. For he who yesterday was your enemy may tomorrow be your ally. And for me, has particular significance. I am a First Nations people, or as we are often dubbed, Native American. That means that my great-great-great-grandfather fought as the enemy, the same United States military that I honorably served some 150 years later. This theme is repeated over and over again. The British were our enemy during the American Revolution, but we later supported them through the trials of World Wars I and II, and continue as strong allies. Even now, they serve along with us in the trial, in parts of the world, just as Germany, Japan, and even Russia have joined us in armed conflicts and peacekeeping missions around the world. Brother fought against brother in the Civil War. An even more current example of the ironic fact is that Iraqis, who were most surely fighting against us, American forces in Iraq in October 2001, now certainly are part of the Iraqi coalition being trained, commanded, fighting, and dying alongside American troops in an ongoing joint military operation in Iraq. When you see the pictures of the old World War II veterans from the U.S., Britain, Germany, France, Russia, or Italy, can you tell the difference without looking closely? Or when you see a picture of a military cemetery, can you tell without being told if it is an American who is buried there? Or if the cemetery is even in this country? Most times, all you can see when you look at those old veterans is the pride at having done their duty, at having done what their respective countries asked of them. And the sadness that follows most all of us in one way or another for what doing that job has cost. It has become a trend over the past several years that World War II and its some instances Vietnam era and other veterans, have chosen to meet with those who served on the opposite side. I have yet to hear from anyone who has been to one of those gatherings who hasn't been struck by how much alike their feelings and memories are. As a Native American, I am a proud member of a warrior society. The most important thing to a warrior is their honor. A warrior draws respect from those through living from others. I remember how I wrote it. My wife cleaned it up so y'all understand it. Okay. Through living both their code of honor. Therefore, if my enemy lives or dies by their code of honor, they are also entitled to respect. It may not be truly within the letter of this day of observation, the Veterans Day, but it must surely be the spirit of this day of remembrance that we don't just honor those who wore the uniform of the United States Air Forces, but all the other veterans who stood the same test as well. One more point in closing. Just as with those who wore the uniform, there are many others who, although not in military uniform, make their own contributions in their own ways. Without them, military service personnel could not and cannot continue the mission they perform both here and abroad. I have seen the pride in my wife's grandfather's eyes when he talked about the thousands of rounds of ammunition he and others produced at the Sunflower Ammunition Plant during World War II. And the traces of sadness at the memories of the friends who were blown away in the explosions that also accompanied that production. And what about the workers who recently crossed the picket lines in this country to produce bulletproof vests and tires for Humvees in support of our service personnel? I have heard from reliable sources that in some cases they have faced physical violence and other forms of retaliation. Perhaps they have not earned the recognition of a veteran because they have not donned the uniform, but to my mind, they are at least entitled to stand with us because those of us who have worn the uniform could certainly not have done the job we set out to do without them. Thank you.
Specialist Chad Sparks, Washburn grad, United States Army, Iraq. Specialist Stephen Wooten, United States Army, currently serving. Specialist Adam Tucker, United States Army Reserve, currently enlisted, current Washburn student. Specialist Bonnie Tucker, United States Army in Iraq. Dale Eugene Langston, Private First Class, United States Army, World War II, Pacific Theater, Philippines. Charles S. Allen, Staff Sergeant, United States Army, killed in Iraq, January 2006. David Doze, Staff Sergeant, United States Air Force, 2002 to 2007. Jesse Doze, Staff Sergeant, United States Marine Corps Weapons Company, Iraq, injured December 11, 2006. Melville Wesley Beaver, Master Sergeant, United States Army Air Corps, World War II. Wallace R. Kidd, deceased, Colonel, United States Army, post-World War II. Elliot Maurice Kidd, Lieutenant Commander, United States Navy, currently serving as Reserve Naval Officer. The late Herbert W. Bass, Sr., Sergeant, United States Army, World War II. William D. Altus, Captain, United States Army, World War II. David James Ramberg, Corporal, United States Army, Vietnam, 1971-73. Graduated Washburn, May 1976. Passed away 2007. Cleveland T. Martin, Machinist Mate, First Class, U.S. Navy, World War II. Jared Burney, Lance Corporal, Marines, Operation Iraqi Freedom, currently attending Washburn, son of Deborah Moore in HR. Louis Soldina, Petty Officer, First Class, United States Navy, World War II, and Korean conflict, attended Washburn, and father of Lou Olson. Ronald Soldina, Major, United States Air Force, Desert Storm, graduated from Washburn. Curtis Van Dong, Sergeant, U.S. Army, Operation Iraqi Freedom, currently attending Washburn. Gary Boutel, Major, U.S. Army, currently serving in Baghdad since May of this year, and Washburn grad, 1994. Richard Ellis, Sergeant, United States Army and Army National Guard, 1999 to 2005, Kosovo and Iraq. Orrin Gardner, Gunner Mate 3, United States Navy, World War II, 1942 to 45. Quentin Russell, Sergeant, United States Air Force, Vietnam. Randy Sanders, Sergeant, United States Army, Vietnam. N.W. Rigger, Army, World War II, in India. Ray Rigger, Air Force, World War II. Elmer Rigger, Army, World War II. Fern Rigger, Army, World War II, Japan. Joe Rigger, United States Marines. Gerald Lyons, Navy, World War II, and also in the Air Force Reserves. Bill Wadley, Mac McMillan, United States Army. We remember these and so many, many more. And we thank them for all of their service and for their sacrifice. Fallen veterans and placing wreaths in their memory. those veterans fallen in the United States Coast Guard we placed this wreath. We're nearing the close of our program. Before the prayer song begins, I would like to thank you for coming. I would also like to invite you to attend our reception in the Memorial Student Union. We have some displays and some refreshments and some veterans to visit with. So I hope you can come for that part. This time, we will join in listening to the prayer song by standing.
Stand for benediction. From Psalm 84. O Lord our God, hear my prayer and give ear, O God of Jacob. For a day in your courts is better than 1,000 elsewhere. I would rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than dwell in the tents of wickedness. For the Lord God is a sun and a shield. The Lord will give grace and glory. No good things will he withhold from those who walk uprightly. Blessed is he who trusts in you. As we go forth from this Veteran Day ceremony, we ask your blessings in our lives to keep us on the path of virtue and righteousness. In gratitude, we pray for our active duty servicemen and women and ask your blessings upon their families for the grace to persevere, especially during these upcoming holiday seasons. We also commend to you, O Lord, those units that are about to be deployed again, a second or even a third time. Give them all the strength to do their duty. May they be blessed. All this we ask in your holy and wonderful name that is above every other name. Amen. Please remain standing for our chaps. Thank you.